Welcome back, guys, to the OPL, where we just saw Chiefs take Game 1 over Sing Gaming. Rest of that best of three coming up around the corner. I'm Still Spawn with Soul Strikes and Frost Goon. Before we dive into Game 2, I do actually want to hit up on what the Chiefs were doing over at IWCI. Unfortunately, it was a little bit of a disappointing tournament for the team. They went 3-5, only being able to pick up wins against Brazil as well as the Latin American teams. They dropped off against Japan, Turkey, CIS, as well as the GPL region there in Southeast Asia. So, you know, I wasn't really here, guys. Like, what did we learn from this? You guys were both here. What did we learn from IWCI and the Chiefs, I guess?
I feel like it was a pressure game. It's so strange. Chiefs, you know, under pressure on the international stage, they seem to have a curse about them, something hanging over their heads, but they continue to kind of fumble. But the thing is, you know, people consistently focus on, you know, why can't Oceania perform at these international results? When if you actually look at everything that the region has to overcome to compete on the same standard that other wildcard regions do, I actually think that they perform quite well.
Yeah, and like they could have done better, but yeah. Well, personally, I watched all of their games. They did adapt throughout the tournament, but unfortunately, they only came up with 3 wins. Hopefully, with the gaming house being introduced to the strongest team that's right now in Oceania, hopefully Chief can get ahead and. Some performance.
Put it on the board.
Yeah.
Close it up. No, but that's the, you know, bringing up the gaming house. Like, that's the other big thing. You know, you think about what does the Oceania region has to compete against when you look at someone like Brazil. You know, these teams are so much stronger in their infrastructure. They have gaming houses. That the fact that Hellions, Legacy, and Chiefs just got one. The best team in the OPL just got their own gaming house. That Australia is such a remote region. How much it would cost to move
and
these
New
teams.
Zealand, you know. We've got
New
Fiji
Zealand.
In there as well.
Exactly.
Just shout out to the rest of Oceania there.
It's just, you're in this tiny little corner of the globe. I mean, Brazilian teams, they can't scrim on the North American servers, but they can boot camp to North America. They can send their teams there. You have the hard random as well as Turkey able to scrim effectively on the EU West servers. We can't connect to any of these other servers. We can't move our team. So, you know, despite all of that, I still think that Oceania puts up a good front.
And does it tell us anything? Like, I guess what I want to do is bring it back to this season now. I mean, we just saw Game 1. Chiefs look back in their dominant domestic form. Like, does IWCI tell us anything? Or is Chiefs still the team that you just look at in Oceania and teams fear?
I think their coach said it best that, you know, if you want to sling crap at the Chiefs about not being able to perform the international stage, you have to beat them first. You can't, you know, throw shade and not step up.
Yeah, I completely agree. You got to beat the best to be the best. So, yeah, just beat the Chiefs and you'll be representing the wildcard.
Easier.
You know, just, you know, knock it out there. All right, so that's what I want to move to, all right? We saw a lot out of the Chiefs. What do we want to see out of the scene going into this next game to, you know, step up and have a crack at the title?
Just drafting. My personal opinion is that the Chiefs completely updrafted Sin in Game 1. They executed on that draft particularly well. And can you imagine if instead of 3 Cloud Drakes, that was 3 Ocean Drakes in particular? It would have snowballed even further out of control. So a bit more of consistency there. I don't think that the Ryze into the Trundle was the best pick in particular, just because Trundle's going to counter out Ryze so well by zoning him away with the pillar. The big thing about Ryze is that he needs some way to augment him so he can get into these team fights, just because he doesn't have any mobility himself.
But what was it about the draft? I mean, we watch RNG so much. You give that draft to RNG, right? This is over MSI. That's the latest tournament. That's why I'm bringing it up. I mean, Maokai, Ryze, Kindred, Twitch. Like, that's a pretty good draft on paper. Like, was it execution? Was it because it was scaling too hard, didn't get ahead in the early game?
It's the other answer to this specific draft. The fact that, yes, you have the Ryze there, and you have, like, Kindred and Maokai, but Soraka puts a silence underneath Ryze, you pretty much lose all of your damage output. You have the Trundle, so Ryze would never be able to get on top of you. I mean, there were just answers there, and yeah, it comes down to execution for a portion of it.
What else you want him to change? Soldiers, quickly?
Yeah, definitely. Like you said, like, play the RNG comp. Like, I definitely like the Sin comp, but it's just what Chiefs had. Like, their comp, like, was a lot better to counter-react to what Sin had. So maybe if with the two bans, extra bans they have this time, they could, like, get rid of the Soraka, get rid of the Nidalee or the LeBlanc, perhaps.
All right, we'll see which adaptations they do choose to make. Players are ready to get onto Rift for game number 2. So here is Atlas and Russell to take us there.
Thank you very much, Spawn. Very excited to get into game number two. And what do you think, Rusty? What do you think the adaptation needs to be from Sin to be able to survive?
I think that the biggest problem was what they gave the Chiefs. And let's be perfectly honest, they had one ban. I think they can get rid of the Soraka this time around, maybe make life a little bit easier for them. LeBlanc's obviously still a big deal in Swiffer's hands, so the Azir ban also maybe not as necessary. I feel like there might be other opportunities for them there. And whilst the Sin's draft, which was just heavily spoken about on the analyst desk, was Sin's draft was good, Chiefs' draft counteracted that completely.
Well, we'll see exactly what happens here as Sin move over to the blue side. See what they take away first, of course. Yes, all of the bans now available for Sin. Staying with the Azir ban first up. Chiefs, of course, I believe it was Victor, Alistar, and then another champion.
There was another champion ban, absolutely correct.
It was Lucian. Lucian was the final ban for the Chiefs first time around, but Sin will be able to not only ban Azir.
Sorry, it was just like getting the Da Vinci Code.
Yeah, I know, right?
The conviction.
It was Lucian. It was Lucian. Bum, bum, bum.
The Azir absolutely banned. That was, again, I questioned that, but because they have three bans, they've got a lot more creative license available to them.
Exactly right, and they get rid of the Ryze here, so Rhymeister not going to be worrying too much about getting silenced by Soraka's, anything like that. Trundle actually going to hit the bench here as the Chiefs lose their first pick from game number one, making sure Sin can't snap that one up and giving a lot of priority to the champion.
Yeah, absolutely, and that to me says that Swiper was actually picking it, not only because it's a strong champion, but to stop Squiggle from having it.
Yeah, very good point.
It's also something that needs to be considered. Same thing goes for the Ryze, to be fair, from Rhymeister. I feel like it was going in that direction.
Ooh, Zed actually going to be the final ban here from Sin. So a lot of mid lane focus here as far as that banning is concerned. Yeah, exactly right. Sin could opt into that. Rhymeister, of course, last split showing fantastic LeBlanc play throughout the time. Chiefs now considering their final ban. Of course, Lucian is available.
Yeah, I think they have to ban the Lucian. If they don't, it should be picked.
Well, Sin can opt into that if they want to.
So there's still Poppy, there's still Echo, there's still Victor. Top lane options available. Victor actually is a big standout, this mid lane pick that's there. And what the Chiefs have done by banning the Maokai is giving them a choice. So do you want the AD carry or do you want the mid laner?
Yeah.
Because if you go for the Lucian, they'll most likely respond with a Victor pick here from the side of the Chiefs. See what they prioritize.
Well, Raps is going to have that Juliet carry there towards the bottom side of the map. Swiper with his ever-present hover of the Tryndamere, his favorite champion. We'll see what they do actually decide to take away. Of course, Kindred is available here as well if Spooks wants to opt into that instead of the Nidalee. But of course, probably no real need to focus on the jungle just yet. We'll see what they take away.
They could. It depends what they want to do, right?
Yeah.
You don't have to focus the jungle, but you can still take away that very strong champion that they excelled on in game number one.
Ooh, Echo has been locked in here as Spooks takes away the Kindred like you were talking about. So top lane and jungle locked in here for the Chiefs.
Yeah, but here's question number two.
All right.
Where's Lucian going to go? Because it's good mid. It's very good mid. Arguably better mid than AD carry.
What's the quote from Bomb the Hellion's mid laner? Just Lucian in every role, right?
Yeah, I asked him what a strong champion was and he said Lucian every role.
Yeah.
Strong champion. So, you know what? It's correct. I wouldn't play it top lane, but it would be strong.
Oh, Rhymeister actually is going to lock away the Victor. Looking like Raps is going to be taking that Lucian towards the bottom side of the map. And Juve's now will be able to pick up his jungler, maybe a support, maybe something else here as Bard being looked at. My God, that is a strong lane. Sin looking to dominate potentially, but it is going to be the Poppy picked up. Squiggle probably going to be playing that one. They move that towards the top side, but Rogue could pick it up if he wants to. Of course, we've, you know, seen Poppy in all sorts of different roles.
So the Chiefs have given over what is obviously still, in my opinion, this is the second game of the OPL that we've seen and the second game that we've watched on 6.10.
Yep.
Lucian and Victor, the two strongest people in their respective roles, perhaps besides the banned champions. And you have to remember that three of them are banned, so Victor naturally is where they should fall towards. And I'm questioning, where's Swiffer going to go here? Does he default to the LeBlanc once again? And it was very successful in the first game. But they're also giving, I guess it's needless strength to a Sin roster.
Yeah, and Rhymeister, of course. I mean, we spoke about Swiffer playing Victor, but Rhymeister also has had many, many games on the champion. And look, his playstyle hasn't changed. He just does a heck of a lot more damage with that Chaos Storm. But Radiant and Ejim going to lock in their bottom lane there. The Bard being picked up. Ezreal Bard, a lane that can be very frustrating to deal with.
Yeah, akin to the Blitzcrank Ezreal in the way that they pressure lanes, which means you cover half the lane each.
Yep.
So one attacks from the bottom side, one attacks from the top side, and you go inside and just pressure them out.
Well, Nidalee and Thresh have been picked up here by Sin, so an engaged support by Rogue, a champion that he had a lot of success on in the first split of the OPL for 2016. And the Wifesteal bottom lane to come in for Sin, so very scary. And Nidalee, a champion that Juve sort of warmed up to throughout the split.
Absolutely. Juve is very much a warming up to champion player as well. So not always fast to the mark, understands what makes it strong, but definitely comes into his stride the more he plays that champion and finds his expertise available to him. Sin finishing off their team composition as well with the Wifesteal bottom lane. They've got the Victor as well mid, and a lot of pressure available around the map through their lanes alone.
Looks like a really scary team.
It absolutely is.
Maybe a little bit short range potentially, but they've got the spears from the Nidalee out of Juve. It just looks well-rounded with the flank potential out of the Poppy. LeBlanc is going to be the answer, like you mentioned. Swift are going to take that one once again. 9-0-3, definitely a good scoreline for game number one, but we'll see whether he can replicate it into what could be a pretty scary lane for the Chiefs mid laner. Rymaster actually opting in to take the barrier just to keep himself alive against the burst.
Barry also got a slight buff.
Yeah, like it.
It does a little bit more in the way of protecting you also. So once again, Sin, they've built a decent team composition. Their drafting is definitely sound, but this is something different from the Chiefs. They're not playing that pokey, methodical, play the map style when they run Sin around. They are actually looking to meet them and fight them and actually stand their ground this time.
Yeah, and Echo, of course, falling through the draft completely in game number one, Swiping out opting into it game number two. And as far as the move to 6.10 after 6.8 that we most recently saw MSI on, I mean, has Echo changed at all? Is he still sort of that dominant top laner?
Echo's pretty much the exact same, yeah. There's no real massive changes to the champion. I think there might be more inklings as time goes on that they might dabble in the mid lane version of it.
Yeah, some mid lane dabbling, I like it.
Yeah, with all the bans that were also there, the two champions played last game were banned by the Chiefs. So
yeah,
still very strong team compositions. The top laners, they're always going to hang around Poppy and Echo.
Well, these are the team comps on your screen right now. Make sure you hop over to Twitter, use that hashtag SinWin if you think that Sin are going to be able to even out this series, or use that hashtag ChiefWin if you think that our OPL legends are going to be able to take this series down 2-0. I'm very excited to see new Victor on the Rift. Definitely something that I haven't seen just yet, but does seem extremely dumb on paper.
Yeah, yeah, he does a lot of damage.
Yeah.
Some would say too much damage. Of course, the level 6, the ultimate changes.
Yeah.
Pulsating damage and a lot of it.
Just ridiculous. But we are onto the Rift, ladies and gentlemen. Sin on our blue side, Chiefs on the red. Keystone Masteries. Any interesting factors? Probably the Thunderlords on Thresh, but has been something that's been happening a lot.
I will say that is the Rogue special, though, going for the Thunderlords on Thresh. Seems to be something he's most comfortable doing. Not really a standard support Keystone user.
Well, Juve's... Oh, there it is. First blood has been taken.
Not never mind.
Yeah, Radio answering back here quite nicely.
What are you doing?
Gets a ward in there. Gets another one back. The Radiant unable to kill that one. Knew that, just wanted to make sure he asserted as much dominance as possible.
No one man, if they're playing Ezreal, can take out an entire ward. So sending a message by getting two hits on it.
Yeah.
Ready?
Oh. Cheeky. Trying to scout that one out, but wraps. Oh, one more. Doesn't quite get the Thunderlord's proc. And Chiefs once again leave another ward barely hanging on here in the jungle.
Yeah, Raps will start this lane though, missing a fair chunk of health. I would imagine the double golems or the Krugs is where they're going to start.
Yeah, it looks like standard lanes might be what ensues from this one. Academy Echo there towards top side of the map as Swiper happy to start things off for Spooks on these Krugs. Sin going to do the same thing with their bottom lane, but standard lanes this game, who is it helping out, Rusty?
I don't think it helps out one over the other. Of course, there's a lot of pressure available for a Bard and an Ezreal in the way of winning the lane. But it goes without saying that a Thresh Loot, you know, pretty strong in their own right. So it comes down to how they play this out. Even both going towards that early level 2 start. Remember, the kill experience is actually only on kills now as well as a 6.9. So someone gets level 2 a lot quicker than the others. And they chose the Lucian for that one in the Ezreal for the Chiefs.
A nice Mystic Shot is going to land there from Radiant. Laning dominance asserted, but Rymaster sets himself up a shield and actually wins out on that trade with the Death Ray afterwards. Clipper popping a potion. Snowmaster doing the same thing.
Rule of thumb is the damage is about the same between the level 2 LeBlanc and the level 2 Victor if all spells connect. Easier to do as LeBlanc, but because you have a shield when you're playing the Victor, you actually win that.
Squiggle in trouble here as Swiper pressuring him out of lane. Corrupting Potion ticking down here for the Poppy, so might be able to hang around. The dominance asserted for Swiper. Oh, phase dive comes in but doesn't hit the Timewinder. That could have spelled death.
Yeah, but Squiggle can't stay. Honestly, he should be recalling right now. Swiper can't push fast enough, and yes, you'd have to blow the teleport. But by staying, I feel like he's getting very greedy for a bit of extra farm so that he can recalls and get something meaningful in his back pocket. He's getting the farm.
He isn't. Timewinder once again, not going to find it. Phase drive resonance. Not going to pop out here, but Spooks coming around the side looking for Rhymeister. Chains land from Swiffer. There's the flash. Chiefs get exactly what they're looking for.
Yeah, Swiffer's getting a little bit low from that, all things considered, but a lot of early pressure now established once again by this Chiefs team. And more ensues.
Yeah, Airbuff gonna beat out Juve.
Juve's at level 2. He really cannot afford to do this trade.
Yeah, Juve's actually opting in for the start of the enemy blue in order to try and get a 3-buff. As Rogue's gonna find his way over the top. There's the flash as EGM's gonna make his way back in.
Nice
Death Sentence lands! And Radiant is so incredibly low. The Ignite goes down to Raps, but he flashes over the top. First blood for Rogue is Spooks. He's going to find his way in. There's a flash forward as Raps will be paying the price for this one. And Swiper is going to try and get more back. The tiniest magical journey of your life is going to come in. And there's the stun down from the parallel convergence. Juve's can't find too much, and it's a 2-for-1.
But this is all a byproduct of Juve's being level 2. Is Spooks has more pressure, Spooks has the red buff, and they have absolute control. Sin do well to actually get themselves that kill on Radar at all. They execute mechanically quite smart, and this is all coming down a Rogue with the flash play as an example, right? So everything goes well for them, but they just don't have the numbers. There is nothing Juve's can do with level 2, and they just immediately rotate. Remember, both flashes burn, so small detail, big deal. Honestly, even the teleport is an advantage that Swiper will have that's now about to grow, because Squiggle's losing lane.
Yeah,
again, everything just unwinds in the right way for the Chiefs.
Well, you can see Rhymeister just farming things out here in the mid lane. Swiffer did head back to base. Actually heading back right now after grabbing himself some popcorn chicken. So we shall see exactly what ensues. Fiendish Codex picked up by the mid laner, but everything evened out here by Rai, who does have his flash down. We'll see whether the Chiefs make a revisit to that lane.
You know the worst part about that entire thing?
What?
Is that Raps didn't even get the kill. It was Rogue.
Yeah.
And he's behind in farm.
Oh, sick! Hook comes in there. There was a playback. Arcane Shift gets rated to relative safety but loses half of his health bar. Man, that was a smooth hook.
Now, we've always said this about Rogue and his Thresh. He needs to be respected. He does hit all of these hooks. But Spooks isn't done.
Yeah, Spooks finding his way over. Swipe is here as well. Wants to find the phase dive over the top. Flash has to be burnt. And he's pressured out of his jungle. Juve's, unfortunately, just paying for that greedy start on the enemy blue.
And when it rains, it pours right now. And this pressure coming out of the Chiefs lineup is near unbearable. Once again, the saving grace is pure mechanics out of this Sin bottom lane. But still, the CS discrepancy between AD carries. Nice stun.
Yeah, Raph's actually taking a lot of damage there from EGM as well.
Channeling is in a Licorit.
Well, Chains are going to miss here as Swiffer taking so much damage. Spooks is going to make his way over the top, but the Death Ray is going to cause Swiffer a lot of hurt. Rhymeister, though, just burning to death. Spooks picks that kill up. And Chiefs, the 2v1, not enough for this all-powerful Victor.
Yeah, Rhymeister recognizing a bad situation, opting into trying to kill Swiffer above all else. Juve needs to show respect because Swiffer is level 6 and he hasn't used that mimic yet at all.
Very scary backup.
So it's such a weird start though, honestly. Like, the Chiefs are in absolute control, and to me this just comes down to Spooks out jungling Juve, plain and simple.
Yeah. And I mean, this is something that, you know, Sin wanted to do at the beginning. They knew that this was the start that they were looking for, but Chiefs just seem to have the best idea. Mountain Drake available. Sue does want to take that one down. You can see Squiggle able to fight back here against Swiper, but yeah, he's looking for it. Timewinder comes in. Phase dive coming down, looking for the stun, but doesn't get it. uses his ult just to get himself a little bit of extra health back.
That was unusual.
Yeah, that was a strange one.
Stamping authority, I suppose. Showing that he has the ability to win all of these trades still, Swiper. And naturally, you don't expect Poppy to do too well against the Echo, but he lost very heavily early. And it's come to backfire pretty much massively. Swiper's been impacting the map. Squiggle's just kind of been left with his tail between his legs.
Yeah, it did give him an opportunity to get a little bit of that farm back. So, I mean that's something. But
yes,
Swiper's but just so dominant. You're exactly right.
Yeah. Really, something's not enough at this stage. Juves as well is caught up in farm, like he's doing perfectly fine in that department. Mid lane's the exact same. Bottom lane's the only one where the discrepancy has stayed the same. So it's not too big of a deal, right? Farm, not the issue. Juves is not doing anything efficiently. Whereas every time we've seen Spooks look for a gank, look for something proactive, it's been effective.
Yeah, well, Rogue is going to get in there. The flash immediately into the magical journey in Ejim. It's going to be well and truly safe. Juves unable to find the gank after sitting around for quite some time.
Yeah, exactly. Time wasted, not even time spent. They got a flash for a flash. All things considered, the magical journey saving Ejim there. And we'll see how Chiefs actually continue to mount this pressure.
Yeah, Swiper actually looking for something here as well, as Swiffer does get the chain to come down. Swiper in there as well. Spooks, oh my god, has to use the Lamb's Respite. Squiggle, he's going to make his way in, but Juve's taking a lot of damage. The flash immediately, double kill comes in as Spooks survives it for the longest time.
Oh no.
Squiggle doesn't find the ultimate though, and Ejim's paid his visit to the mid lane. Swiper now with a lot of movement speed, and Squiggle's just going to get darted around and destroyed. Swiffer picks up his kill, and Chiefs 6-2 at 9 minutes.
Yeah, and what a disaster for Sin this early in the game. You could see Spooks wasn't prepared for the amount of burst that came out of Rhymeister's. I guess it was like the residual Chaos Storm that kind of just hung around.
He was just melting. That Chaos Storm does so much damage over time now.
Yeah, it does a lot. But the only thing they get from it is more pressure in this bottom lane. But still, no kills. And here's the teleport to consolidate.
Yeah, Swiper looking for a parallel convergence coming down. We'll see whether Sin can avoid it as Rogue is going to get stunned up. They're going for the easy kill where they can. Swiffer now looking for wraps. Flashes underneath his turret, but Swiffer gets in on top. And Swiper ults his way out. This Chiefs squad looking so coordinated.
Total dominance is established.
Total domination.
Yeah, absolutely right, Atlas. Something. What the hell?
You haven't seen that movie? Bring it on, man. Bring it on, references. That's all we need.
All right. Look. Now I don't know what I was saying.
Just remember.
Disaster. I was in the middle of saying disaster for Sin. That's just disaster across the board now. What a disaster.
Yeah. Well, Spooks is actually going to start counter jungling now as well. And the Chiefs 8-2. And it's just how they're going about it as well. I mean, the lead isn't massive. I mean, it's like 2,500 gold. Not a Juves real problem, but Juves. Okay, he's in trouble. And who chases after an Echo is looking for the pounce. Phase Dive's going to be there though. Fantastic use of that Steadfast Presence. And Squiggle's going to save his jungler. Dominance still asserted.
But like, it's at the point where Swiper saw Squiggle as he jumped over that wall blind and said, oh, well, I'll damage you two on my way out just because I can.
Yeah.
Realistically, that's a lot of control that Swiper has on this top lane. And that top lane, even without teleports available, doesn't really matter to the Chiefs because they just go straight towards this dragon. They secure that one on their way through and they're zoning bottom.
And immediately Swiffer moves over, and if Juves came anywhere near that dragon, he was dead. Swiffer just combos him all the way down. Swiper and Squiggle actually going relatively low here towards the top side. Phase dive from Swiper, but you can see Corrupting Potions being utilized over and over again. A little bit more useful there from Swiper. Gets himself the shield from the phase dive, and actually, that's a lot of damage coming in. Buckley going to be picked up there as a heroic charge comes down. The ultimate for the damage there, the flash forward, and Swiper gets the 1v1.
Yeah, Swiper completely outplaying Squiggle.
That was beautiful.
Again, this Echo. Swiper's actually displaying some very crisp mechanics here.
Yep, chain going to land here from Swiffer. He's looking for it onto Rhymeister. Lands another chain. Flashes out of the Chaos Storm. As my god. Chaos Storm just does so much damage. Rhymeister is going to survive for now. Primal Surge onto him. Help keep him in that lane.
Spooks is here though. See if he can catch him.
Does he? Moves out of the way. Juves is going to get slowed down. Gravity Field is there, but Spooks just skirts around the side. Lots of damage. There it is with the Sigil. And Swiffer picks up a cheeky kill.
And just like that, like again, who walks through a ward and still finds themselves getting a kill? Sin just seemed completely out of sorts in this second game of the best of three they're in. Everything going right for the Chiefs. Even the level 2 cheese that Ejim has been doing consistently in solo queue that everybody despises and says they'll actually get him out doing it still works. They couldn't do a mistake if they tried.
Yeah, and also having four men at the ready to capitalize on that one kill, pick up the outer turret in the mid lane. It seems like everything's going from good to better for the Chiefs. Reedy now defending this outer turret. Raps and Rogue knocking on the door, but there is a Bard to help out. Very close to the death sentence there from Rogue. Can't quite find the slippery Ezreal. No. Reedy 120 to 106, so still doing really well.
Yeah, Raider is actually just 1v2ing essentially in this bottom lane.
Yeah.
Really yet to see Rogue or Raps leave the bottom lane at all. They don't need to. Well, they kind of have to though, that's the thing. Like, everywhere else is struggling. There's just no immediate answer available.
Well, there's a Steadfast Presence. Squiggle is going to be able to pick up his Buckler, has the extra shield. C-Drive Resonance just going to get Swiper as far away as he wants. Rhymeister does find himself the Rift Scuttler. Chaos Storm goes down. Swiper looking for a kill here as Parallel Convergence. He's trying to find the stun, but he's going to get stunned himself. Chrono Break going to get himself to safety. Completely out of mana, though. The Echo going to have to stop fighting for now.
Yeah, but it's just more damage onto Rhymeister. And remember, that's forcing him to recall, which means Swiffer and Spooks, who are holding hands in this middle lane, actually have time to rotate around the map and get things done. It's even Ejim collapsing. The next step, you would assume, is bottom lane. So look at the way Swiffer is stancing himself. He knows that Cole's bottom. He knows that Juz is mid.
Yeah, knows that someone has to make a transition.
He expects the rotation.
Well, Flash immediately out of the way of the Tempered Fate. Good trade there for Ejim.
It's just like they're thinking cerebrally like at another level to what Sin are reacting to. And this is the same thing as the first game all over again, but with a more aggressive team composition from the Chiefs.
Well, Juve's actually looking to try and get something back here against the Chiefs, but look at how fast this Echo is. A passive is silly. Even without the ultimate, it's still going to be fine.
Yeah, able to get that proc and just walk it out. Juve's being top lane. It's not really getting them anything, and it's an unfortunate thing because we're watching the implosion of an entire draft and gameplay out of Sin. It showed so much promise at the start of this game, but when it came to the crunch, Chiefs are performing at this point in the game very much superior.
Yeah, it was looking very scary actually out of the gate. But Chiefs just showing that if you've got early dominance and strategic movements around the map, it doesn't really matter what champions you are.
And it is the Bloodraiser as well for Spooks.
Yeah.
He's doing a lot of percentage health damage.
He's going to get hold out of position there. Uses the Lance Respite. It's a big cooldown down. The Ignite very, very late. Might be enough here. Not going to quite be as the passive is going to come through from that W. Spooks is going to be fine. Another back-to-back hook there as Swipe is going to get caught out. Does have the ultimate this time. Chrono breaks himself to safety. But Rogue really fighting back here for Sin.
But remember, look at where they're fighting. Like, past the first turret, zoning them at the second. And mechanically, Sin are playing this game great. Like, they really are. They're doing fine in 1v1s, they're doing fine in their laning phase, except for the hiccup that Squiggle made in that top lane. But he's against a big Echo anyway. Like, that's something that you can't really avoid when they're that far ahead. It just comes down to how they're moving around the map. And the problem is they're not.
Yeah.
Like, you can win those 2v2s, you can force the Kindred ultimate, you can force the Echo ultimate, but the rest of the team is already hitting your turret to take down global gold for the rest of the team. Chiefs are making active team efforts where Sin are playing for themselves.
Yeah, they're objective-based decisions that are going to net them something as soon as they take it. And the Chiefs, despite the fact that they get hooked, get caught out of positions, things like that, things are still fine. Spooks goes back, finishes up the Hurricane. This is a very aggressive Kindred build.
And that's very far ahead of, as well of Juve's.
Oh, yeah.
Really has no choice. If he goes for the Rod of Ages, he's making a mistake, really.
Well, it looks like the Rylaze is what's coming in here. Parallel Convergence is going to give a bit of a shield there to Swiper as he makes his way towards the top side of the map. 20% CDR already picked up for the Echo. As double Mountain Drake coming in. If we get another triple.
So, like, even before we look at that, just remember that this is going to be uncontested. It's going to be taken. That is an unreasonably fast 20-minute barrier. Because they have a Bloodrazor Kindred that can just destroy its health bar with two mountains doing 8% true damage.
Swiper not going to quite find a stun here as the heroic charge is going to knock him out. Juve's going to take him down. That was a very over-aggressive move there from Swiper. The rest of the team, is making their way up. They're not going to quite get there in time. Another flash is going to get gained from the Tempered Fate. But Sin are going to be safe. Massive Mimic Distortion onto three from Swiffer. Heads back towards his Distort. They are going to keep him off the turret.
And again, the idea was there from the Chiefs, but Swiper bites off more than he can chew.
Yeah.
Gets knocked into the wall where he made a positional mistake, and that was mechanical, and gets caught out by Sin, who still have damage. And but you can't laugh at what Sin have put together. That team composition always going to be relevant.
Yeah.
Also, very curiously, it's the Essence Reaver attack speed build from Rat.
Yeah, not actually going towards the Ghostblade into the Black Cleaver, something that Frostgrim mentioned and something that you told me about, and I was very scared and excited, depending on which side the Lucian was on.
So, like, it's not a bad decision from Raps. It actually scales into a better build because you get the bonus crit.
Yeah.
So overall, you'll end up doing more damage. They don't have a lot of tanks on the side of the Chiefs either besides the Echo. So you will still technically be doing more damage with this Echo Lucian build. But it's still, you know, I expected the Ghost Blade Black Cleaver.
Well, you can see Chiefs utilizing that Dragon buff in order to take down this Rift Herald. Are going to be able to get it this time, as Swiffer looking to pick up the 20-minute Rift Herald monster buff.
Yeah, 5% damage reduction when he's alone as a LeBlanc actually adds up to be quite a big deal eventually.
Yeah. Well, it looks like Chiefs haven't stopped here as Radia took down that outer turret towards the top side of the map. Heading now down towards this inner. Squiggle and Rai are going to be utilized in order to clear out that minion wave. Sin actually answering here as Swiper almost gets nicked by the death sentence. Stun being looked for, but not going to find it there as Scoot pounces out of the way. There's the flash. Actually gets a Z-Drive Resonance there at the same time as Swiffer looking to make his way in. Chrono Break comes out as Juves is going to die. Swiffer, massive amounts of damage, but gets back to the distortion. He's going to be safe. They get that one pick. Sin looking to try and get out, but here's Ejim and Spooks making their way in. Two versus three, though, before Swiffer is going to make his way in. Swiper coming down as well. Tempered Fate snags Rogue. We'll see what they can do with it as there's the Chaos Storm. Spooks has to use his Lamb's Respite, but Squiggle's going to fall. And Spooks might be in trouble there as well as Raps was looking for it. Very aggressive moves, but he's going to die. And Radia flashing forward, looking for Rhymeister. Doesn't have the ult. Just takes himself a dark passage for safety.
So that was a lot of deaths.
Things happened, Rusty.
That was a lot of kills for the Chiefs once more. They accelerate the game and they turn on the pace in their favor, and it actually does work out for them. You can see how much damage the Victor does. You can see how strong Sin can be. But it almost feels like, even though it's 20 minutes in this game, that it's a too little too late ordeal.
Yeah.
That's a scary prospect. Raps is ham.
Yeah, super ham.
Like, trying to make the best out of a bad situation makes sense, but he was trying to make something out of nothing. And he got nothing.
He certainly did.
He didn't make something.
Spooks was very close to going down. I mean, I understand the idea, but very scary. Swiper, unfortunately, didn't quite find anything in that last fight either. He's got 7 stacks on that Dark Seal.
But still playing it very well, like getting 2 stuns onto the Poppy, dodging the Poppy's ultimate as well, and drawing the pressure of most of the front line of Sin says a lot.
Yeah. 5 pink wards as well in the back pockets of the Chiefs.
They're in the Baron pink ward.
Yep. Now they're moving in. Swiper and Spooks completely alone in this Baron pit. No one with any vision at all. Ejim over the side, wandering it's over gone. Wards, but just does not care. Double Mountain Drake.
Absolutely destroyed.
Radio actually is going to head his way in, but that's 21 minutes. And the Baron falls down. Chiefs now looking to put on the pressure.
But this is just the way that it unfolds, right? You get 2 Mountain Drakes, RNG. You don't know which dragons you're going to get. But it works out that with a Bloodrazor Kindred, who's getting plenty of kills and unmarked targets, just happens to get 2 Mountain Drakes to assist the Baron. And, like, realistically, all you need is one other member there, and Kindred has enough damage for 2 people onto this epic monster with all that percentage health.
That's another triple Drake, by the way. We're going to have 3 mountains in this game. Just crazy. Love it. Love it a lot.
RNG.
Yeah, all of these epic monsters are going to be falling extraordinarily quickly in the hands of the Chiefs. Gravity Field goes down. Swiffer actually looking for it, but Rhymeister not going to fall down just yet. Parallel Convergence locks him up, though. They're trying to get it one in there as the Tempered Fate comes down. Chiefs now biding their time as Spooks heads over the top. The Siege coming down. Jeez. Look at the dodge. The dash is in from the Chiefs from three members. They do manage to take down this turret. Magical Journey going to be picked up. She's going to move over to the next objective.
Yeah, playing that slow pokey style, but with a lot more emphasis on dealing damage this time around. The Chiefs get themselves that turret after they got the Baron buff. The next one's up in 30 seconds, and everything on the map melts to the Chiefs' damage right now. Sin seriously struggling.
Oh, yeah. Spooks almost has that more of Mount Bordy is completed as well. Swiffer going towards the Rabidan's death cap. Here's item number three. He's going to be so frightening. Of course, that Rift Herald buff still going, I believe. Doesn't get overridden by the Baron buff anymore.
Nope.
Here's the Mountain Drake, number three for the Chiefs.
Rhymeister is actually in a very awkward position.
Okay. Rally's going to tag Spooks. As Swiffer actually looking to try and take down Rogue right now. There it is. Distortion going to be enough for that Sigil of Mouse. And now, 4 versus 5. Favor of the Chiefs, this dragon is definitely theirs.
Yep. It's not really a dragon that the Sin lineup should look to contest. Three mountains after getting three clouds in game number one. What a time to be alive.
Yeah, Atlas. The triple Drake feeling. I wonder what happens. Is there, we get any fancy animations
in downtown?
I don't think we do. A little bit sad. But Chiefs now moving towards this inner turret towards the bottom side. Baron buff still doing some work as Radier is battling with Juice. So much damage as Spooks takes him out.
There is no answer. That's the problem. Spooks may be low, but he's got a team backing him, and that damage is unreasonable.
Yeah, in goes Swiffer as well, staying there as he takes himself the lantern. That was a very long chain. But not going to get any snares from that distance.
Yeah, Rogue actually flashing to distance himself further from that Bard ultimate. The base is honestly just going to crumble here. The amount of damage they're doing with three Mountain Drakes to these turrets,
just silly. The Siege power from this team. There's the Culling that comes out from Raps, buying some time, but the teleport coming in from Swiper means that he will be able to zone away from this one. Swiper just destroys Rogue. Not entirely sure what happened to him there as Squiggle trying to close the distance, but Swiper's right in there. Double stun onto both of the carries as Spooks over the top. Still very low. Radia grabs the kill onto Rhymeister. Swiper underneath turrets, utilizes the ultimate. And there's just so many kills across the board. Once again, it's going to be Radius sacrificed. But that is a 1 for 3. And Chiefs are looking for the base.
And that really does go to show how strong this Chiefs roster is right now. Set one of split number two. And Radair is not doing a thing. But this entire Chiefs lineup is destroying Sin.
And once again, Swiffer 9-0-3. The shutdown comes in. As he doesn't manage to pick up another, I think that that is the scoreline he's going to get. And Sin are doing the very best that they can to avoid any of those numbers going higher, apart from the death count.
Yeah, this gold lead as well. You'd have to imagine that at this point in the game, they will recall, they will look towards their final push, because the base is theirs to take. They just need to man up, get in there and do it.
Yeah, massive gold scores here at the same time. You can see that gold difference well over 10,000. At 25 minutes in. It's just methodical and calculated from the Chiefs this whole time through. And it just seems like they're just, they pick up what they get and do with it the perfect thing. So like three mountains, let's just get all of the neutrals, take the turrets extraordinarily quickly. They understand exactly what this new patch does for them.
They're the ones
with the control on these dragons. They're the ones that have been focusing that objective down.
Like, the best teams in this current patch are the ones that can pivot the best. And
yeah,
you draft the standard team composition, you draft for any situation that may actually arise, because you build a scaling comp and you don't get fire dragons, or you build a scaling comp and you happen to get the fire dragons. Like, you never know what you're going to get. But if you can react to it accordingly and then work around the map based off that, you'll look like one of the best teams, no doubt.
Well, Chiefs have been doing so far. Super minions streaming towards the bottom side of Sin's base. Radia just standing vigil at this inhibitor turret. That getting zapped just a little bit of Swiffer. Makes his way over the top. Juice gets sniped as Swiffer grabs the kill. 10-1-3 on the LeBlanc. He is huge right now as he heads over the top one more time. Squiggle is a tank. Swiffer, you're probably not going to be able to delete him, but he does a pretty good job. The Rabidans is completed.
It's not about deleting him. It's about poking him out, right? They will go towards this turret now. They have a numbers advantage. Just comes down to poking Raps or Rhymeister this time.
Yep, cheeky sigil from Swiffer. A Swiper heads straight over the top. Gets shielded up, but you can see this turret is melting. Chaos Storm comes in, but it's not doing any damage. Swiffer finds Rogue on the side, but doesn't get the deletion. And Sin will have to back away. Half the health now on the turret. And a Squiggle, steadfast presence, no chains to land. And the Swiper's just like, well, I'm over the top now. I may as well kill myself a ward.
He walked over with Swiffer. It was like, hang on, I can't go back. I've made a mistake.
Yeah, the rest of Sin now converging. They can't really do too much. The rest of the Chiefs, they can just magically journey their way in if they want to start this fight off. Gravity Field comes in. Swiffer gets the delete onto Rogue. And there is the Tempered Fate that comes down as well. Squiggle's the only one that's going to get caught out of position. Jubes is going to get destroyed as Radiant picks up that kill. The rest of the Chiefs now on the onslaught as Raps running away. Rhymeister as well, very out of mana. And my god, this Chiefs lineup are doing so much damage and so quickly. The last Nexus turret is going to fall. There's the Lance Respite just for fun here from the Chiefs as they're magically journeying their way over the top. Congratulations, they take down the first series of the OPL for Split 2 2016. The Chiefs looking dominant as ever.
Absolutely right. This is a dominant performance to say the least from the Chiefs.
Oh, yeah.
But I said it before, it's not just Raider. They're actually all performing well. Raider basically watched as the rest of his team won around him and then just hits the Nexus and goes, well done, guys. Plus one for me.
Damn right. And that's once again another game where this was a team pivoting around Swiffer. This guy was doing so much damage. Not to mention the fact that Swipe is getting solo kills there towards the top lane. I mean, we've spoken about this team a lot in the past, and it's the fact that any one member of this squad can be the one to carry them through, and it's exactly what happened this game.
And as far as week one, game one goes, the fact they can all carry, that's a scary prospect for anyone that plays against them.
Yeah, super scary. But ladies and gentlemen, we are going to throw it back to the desk to break down the series victory for the Chiefs.
Thank you so much, Atlas. I think you said it best. Super scary, that Chiefs lineup just then. 28 minutes able to dismantle Sin Gaming, the team that they were able to get the better of in the semi-final. But I don't think anyone expected it to be in such emphatic fashion for this first set.
And to just echo Rusty and Atlas on the cast, I don't think anyone really expected it to be in the hands of Swiffer. Yes, you always talk about how Swiffer is legacy player of the scene, obviously can step up and be that carry. But when you look at Chiefs, it's honestly been Ray Deer as the primary carry it was in the finals. And this time around, the fact that you have multiple threats that are stepping up and going just as big is absolutely terrifying.
Yeah, and the super scary part of the Chief tonight's performance was like all of them carried. Like even Swiper on this Echo, he demolished Squiggle in his lane, just solo killing him, and Swiffer just going off on this LeBlanc, and Spooks just doing whatever what he does, just taking over enemy jungle.
Something that I do want to underline, though, is that we can't hold this to the same regard as the semifinal match because it is a different Sin lineup. Obviously, you have the brand new AD carry as well as a new top laner, Squiggle and Raps respectively coming out for Sin. So it's not like you get to hold it, okay, the Chiefs, they're looking amazing, they're looking dominant, they just took down Sin, Sin faced them in the semifinals last split. No, it's a different lineup, so we need more context before I'm really able to sell, like, oh my god, Chiefs are carrying from every single position in god status.
I agree with you in that regard, but one person that doesn't get a pass, at least in my eyes, is Juves. He went for the Peanut Invade at the start of this game. For those that aren't familiar, that's Wolves to Raptors to enemy blue on Nidalee when you're on the blue side of the map. And what that allows you to do with your pounce is kill the two camps very, very quickly. Should be able to get there, get your level 3 in remarkable time because you clear the camp soul strikes. He fumbled his smite pounce, didn't get the reset, wasn't able to clear, and was punished for it pretty brutally.
Yeah, and he was actually stuck level 2 for a very long time, and Spooks, despite not having his blue buff, he's still up-leveling this, Juves, and just Juves, despite having the blue buff, and perhaps like could go into like 3 buffing the Kindred, but Spooks just got more successful ganks, blue flash from Rhymeister, and just got ahead despite being behind.
And these are questions that we had about Juves at the start of this split. Obviously, a big staple for Sen, his presence and his level 2 gank around the mid lane in particular for Ryemeister, but he hasn't really been that successful and stepped up that much on really mechanically intensive junglers like Nidalee. And we talked about this at the beginning. I feel like the patch shifted out of Juve's favor, moving away from Gragas, moving away from Elise, and into the hands of Kindred and Nidalee really exposes some of his weaknesses.
And with that, Chiefs were able to pick up their first win and maybe look towards the grand final, although it might be a bit too soon. But guys, you should be at home because on August 13th, we will be up in Brisbane for that grand final. Tickets are available at Friday, 6 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time, so make sure you snap them up. However, we have another best of three just around the corner as Abyss Esports will be taking on the Hellions. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in 3.5.